Good evening. Welcome to Left, Right and Center. I'm Vishnu Shom. It's an important program that we actually have today. It's been more than 60 days since the war in Ukraine began. 60 days in which there have been a lot of developments on the battlefield in Ukraine, which have led many to believe that perhaps the technology is evolving. It is changing to such an extent that warfare has indeed evolved. From drones playing a decisive role in the war, the vulnerability of tanks, which have been such an essential part of the battle zone for more than a century, to the role of shoulder-fired missiles, which can easily knock down tanks and aircraft, to information warfare. On a day when India has a new army chief, General Manoj Pande, we thought it would be useful to look at where India stood in terms of the technology curve in war, based on what we've been seeing in Ukraine. Now, we have a brilliant panel of experts tonight, drone specialists, leading military aviators and experts on tanks, men with years of experience on these systems. But first, a compilation of 10 key lessons from the battlefield in Ukraine. And I should immediately stress that the gentleman who will be discussing all of this may or may not agree with me at all. But let's bring up the first point. The first point is this: drones will dominate the battle space. We are seeing that now in Ukraine, and we are going to see that increasingly. Drones offer a cost-effective solution to taking on targets such as tanks, artillery, guns, and other targets in any battle going forward. Increasingly inexpensive drones which cost much less than what fighter aircraft cost, can actually cause damage like what you see on your screen. This is footage of some of the strikes which have been taking place in Ukraine. As you can see, tanks easily have their armor pierced if drones can actually get overhead. And those were small drones. There are all categories of drones. Drones which are dedicated platforms for observation, for intelligence, and drones which can strike. So that's point number one. Let's move to point number two, and we've got quite a few. Anti-tank missiles can easily defeat tank armor. In fact, let's roll that footage that we have on tanks being defeated in the battles in Ukraine so far. Most of these are from drones and from anti-tank guided missiles. We're talking about anti-tank guided missiles by and large. In many cases, these are shoulder-fired missiles. The tank has been such an important part of warfare. Now, if tanks are being taken out in the manner that we've seen in Ukraine, anti-tank missiles easily defeating tank armor, then it's something for us to take pause on here in India and think about it. Why? Because many of the tanks which have failed in Ukraine to defeat these systems include T-90s and T-72s. That's the bulk of India's tank formations. Is the tank in its present avatar something that really works? Let's move to the next point. Low-flying fighters are extremely vulnerable. This is an image of a Russian Su-35. It may or may not have been low-flying, but the point we're trying to make is that the easy availability of surface-to-air missile systems of various degrees of complexity mean that airfield supremacy, or supremacy over the skies of a country like Ukraine, even 60 days after the war began, a country as powerful as Russia has not been able to do that. Why not? That's something that we'll be looking at as well. Let's move with the next couple of lessons. This is one of the reasons why that's not happened. Modern surface-to-air missiles can be decisive. So what you see actually is a Stinger surface-to-air missile system. It's been around for decades, but new models or new variants of this with incredibly sensitive warheads mean that low-flying aircraft in particular are very vulnerable. Why do we talk about low-flying aircraft? It is important that we do that because even in the case of the Indian Air Force, we've had doctrines where we've got fighter aircraft flying extremely low, carrying out gun attacks, carrying out rocket attacks, low-level bombing attacks. In the face of this adversity, it becomes possible for India to now think, is this necessarily the way in which we can carry on meaningful warfare without sustaining a lot of casualties? Let's move to some of the other lessons. Fighter jets need advanced defensive aids to survive. This is a very costly solution. It's available with the Indian Air Force, not necessarily in all of our aircraft, and not necessarily with the same level of complexity or sophistication. Advanced jammers, electronic warfare systems, systems which actually enable aircraft, the pilots to know the direction from which a threat comes, the direction from which a missile is fired. This enables survival for aircraft in a battlefield, right? Over a battlefield. And that is something that needs to be looked at. Attack helicopters have limited use in contested airspace. That's another point that one needs to speak about. What you see over there, the picture you saw just a moment back, and this video is actually also very useful in pointing out that no matter how advanced the helicopters are in airspace which is contested, the prevalence of surface-to-air missile systems, particularly shoulder-fired surface-to-air missile systems, means that, and let's roll that that video, means that helicopters are extremely vulnerable. That helicopter is a Mi-28 helicopter. It's one of the most advanced anti-tank and battlefield support helicopters in the world. Heavily armored, very fast, extremely armed. It gets knocked down, as we've seen, in areas where the airspace is contested because of those surface-to-air missile systems. India's invested a great deal in such helicopters. For example, state-of-the-art Apache helicopters. But the threat of surface-to-air missiles remains very, very real. Let's move to the next point. The next point is warships need state-of-the-art defensive systems. That is the Moskva. That is the Russian cruiser which went down to a precision attack by anti-ship missiles fired by the Ukrainians. It had a very heavily defended three-tier system of defense, but evidently that was not activated and the ship was actually destroyed. So again, a few more images of the Moskva, which was destroyed. So what does this mean for the Indian Navy? Because remember, each warship costs more than $1 billion in many cases, not all cases, but some of the most expensive destroyers that we have, for example, would be in the range of $1 billion each. So warships need state-of-the-art defensive systems. We'll be talking about that as well. The next point that we have, long-range artillery plays a decisive role. Now, this is not new. We've known this in the past. But I think what is new and different now are the types or the varieties of shells these long-range artillery guns actually have, the greater accuracy that they afford, the ability to precisely target or hit certain targets, unlike in the past when artillery was an area weapon, where used to decimate a particular area. It is now increasingly a weapon system that can deliver a very precise hit on a precise target. That alters the battlefield altogether. Let's move to another key point. Now, the next one. Information warfare is key to managing expectations. People need to believe that they are winning or that they are not, if you are being truthful about matters. But either way, it is important to back your statements as a nation, as a country, as a force with actual footage. We didn't have that when the Balakot strikes took place. There was a huge controversy on whether or not we actually struck our targets. Look at what's happening in the case of Ukraine and also Russia. They have got footage coming out each and every day. Drones actually enable that to take place more than ever before. This adds credibility to what you are trying to state publicly, and it also adds credibility to whether or not you are achieving anything substantive. And the final point, and there's no debate about this, but it needs to be mentioned, logistics is equal to life. If you don't have your logistics in order, if you are unable to support your soldiers and weapon systems up in the front, then you will lose. The Russians have lost that battle for Kiev. They were unable to get into the Ukrainian capital because they couldn't maintain their logistics. So in the context of future conflict or even conflict nowadays, how would India ensure that our logistics chains are secure in the event of a war with Pakistan or with China? That's something which our military planners need to look at. Robust logistics. We keep talking about weapon systems, but ultimately it also boils down to the ability of getting trucks, thousands of them, to soldiers in the front line safely so that those soldiers can keep on fighting. Now, we've got some fantastic guests with us. We've got Major General B.S. Dhanoa. He is a tank man for life. He knows more than a thing or two about tanks, and I think he'd disagree with some of the points I mentioned on tanks. We'll find out. Sameer Joshi, possibly India's leading drone expert, a former Indian Air Force pilot, but somebody who has really embraced drone technology to see what it means potentially for India and our armed forces. He's the CEO of New Space Research and Technologies. And Commodore J. Maulankar, a hero of mine, he was the man who flew the Tejas onto the deck of the Vikramaditya. I've had India's aircraft carrier. I've had the privilege of flying on a sortie with him, not in the same aircraft, but two aircraft. He was in the other one. And I've learned a great deal about aviation from him. So let me come to Samir first. Samir, when one speaks about drones, I think the key point to mention is that there isn't necessarily one type of drone which is going to change the battlefield. There are a variety of solutions, but the fact of the matter is, if India doesn't invest in the technology now, then a battle in the future will be difficult to win. Would that be a fair assessment?
Yeah, certainly, Vishnu. Just to take this and give better context to what you have just asked, I'll take you back to Ukraine itself, a prime example. You know, drones have actually made a very huge impact, especially in the last few months. The Russians, you know, were seen to be a little behind in the game, and the Ukrainians were very creative in all sorts of drones. But now, as the battle is shifting towards east, where Donbass, is flat open, here drones are becoming further most and more dominant feature in the conflict. Interestingly, a lesson for us is that both the Ukrainians and Russians are turning to a two-pronged drone strategy. First is they use cheap off-the-shelf drones to keep, a very watchful eye in the sky and to flag targets for artillery or takedown of tanks and defensive positions. Where interestingly, again, DJI drones are highly used in both roles. We've seen China just step in to reduce this functionality for both sides. Also, we have seen a large usage of legacy drones in service, which can deliver precision attack munition. These have included the Bayraktar series, which, were highly visible in the initial few days. Interestingly, now the US is also providing hundreds of kamikaze loitering munition, which can hunt down targets for hours before, dropping down to detonate deadly munition.
Right.
The dynamics of the battle will change forever. Why I'm stating this is, look at the different versions, the different roles, the different types of drones which are proliferating over Ukraine. Each has a certain depth of usage, exploitation. The Bayraktars, which were very omnipresent initially, have reduced their role. We're not seeing a lot of clippings coming out simply because we feel that the Russians, with their air defense now in much better shape at a tactical level, has managed to shut down that capability, especially in Donbass.
Right.
As it's trying to centralize control over the region's airspace. But the smaller size drones, especially the DJI series, and now what we are yet to see, which I've heard that, the first of these kamikaze attack drone has already gone into action.
Right.
We will definitely see that these are drones which are smaller in size, much more difficult to pick up by the standard air defense measures. Hence, the proliferation is going to be far more, not only in use, but also visible in their tactical result. Yeah.
General Dhanoa,
learn a lesson from the war and look at what we need back in the Indian Armed Forces.
General Dhanoa, where does this leave the tank, which has been fundamental to warfare for more than a century?
Good evening, Vishnu, and to both my co-panelists. It's kind of ironic that on the day that we celebrate Armor Day here in India, you have me on a panel where you actually ask me the question as to what is the future of the tank. And definitely on the day that we celebrate as our core day, I am not going to turn around and say that it is the end of the road for the tank. Definitely not. And it's not for any sentimental or emotional reasons. The fact of the matter is that the tank has been on the battlefield for over 100 years. It was brought in on the fields of World War I in France to tackle a particular problem. And that problem was as to how do you get across the very, very difficult terrain which existed. And the tank has after that evolved. And, there's one issue which you did bring up to say that anti-tank missiles will put an end to the tank. The same was said for the tank in 1973 after the Yom Kippur War, when the Egyptians surprised the Israeli armor with the Sagar, which were the first generation anti-tank missiles. And it was within the war itself that the Israelis learned how to counter after having taken horrendous casualties initially. And similarly, there is a learning curve which on the battlefield is much more steeper.
But there is a way out, General. And that means for us here in India, an investment of literally billions of dollars. Active protection systems are there. They've proven to be technologically viable, albeit prohibitively expensive to acquire in large numbers.
Vishnu, I'll take
Is that the way ahead, sir?
See, the active protection system is an unproven system so far. You've had some success with it in the limited amount of tank incursions that, again, the Israelis have done in the Gaza Strip. But to say that it is only an active protection system which is going to give you protection against the kind of threat which exists would be taking it, I would say, to the technological max. Mm-hmm. What you really need is to be able to counter the threat which exists. And unfortunately today, the threat of top attack, be it from drones, be it from your armed UAVs, UCAVs, or be it from top attack anti-tank missiles, which are fire and forget, or be it from home-rigged, small DJI drones that Samir was just speaking about. The fact of the matter is that if you have the right tactics in place and you have a correct visualization of the threat that you're likely to face, even the tactical level and at the operational level, if you have electronic warfare systems, if you have jammers available with you, and you have anti-drone technology available to the troops who are deployed on ground.
Yes.
And at the same time, you do not go speeding down highways where your tank columns are bereft of artillery support, or they do not have adequate amount of air support. So the footage that you have seen is part of the information warfare that the Ukrainians and the Western world has put out.
General Dhano, it's accurate. I have personally counted
all right, but it's
50
only
tanks, sir, approximately 50
you,
tanks.
You are not seeing the success.
The first-hand count. So that information warfare is accurate. I mean, that part of it, sir.
No, see, information warfare is a mix of what is happening on the battlefield, how you are able to put it across to affect the perceptions of different sets of audiences.
Right.
Be it people who you want to, the enemy, your own people, as well as a neutral audience. Okay, so let's count ourselves in the neutral but interested audience. So let's come back to the point that is it the end of the road for the tank? I would say no, it is not.
Okay.
The tank is never meant to be used alone. The tank is meant to be used as a part of a combined arms team. And the faster we get to integrate it, to be able to use it along with infantry, with artillery, with eyes in the air, be it drones, be it attack helicopters, Air Force in direct support and electronic warfare, it is a tough ask. But that's the way we have to go forward. And I'm sure the Indian Army Chief, having taken over today, would have already given a task list to his people that take a look at what we have and how what we need to change.
Commodore Mavlankar, 60 plus days and Russia still doesn't control the airspace over Ukraine. In fact, even in the south and the east of Ukraine, it's still somewhat disputed. The Indian Air Force, for a very long period of time, has focused on front gun attacks. It's focused on rocket attacks. You know, we have year after year air power demonstrations which keep showcasing the skill. It's the same skill set with different aircraft which we've seen for decades. Is there a case now that using aircraft over a battlefield like the one in Ukraine indicates that perhaps aircraft need to be used from greater ranges, that they are extremely vulnerable if used in short ranges? Sir, I think you're muted. Can you just, Commodore, just unmute yourself? Go ahead.
It would be a little presumptuous for me to speak on behalf of the Air Force, but I can tell you that the awareness and the need to avoid these low-level air defense weapons has been something that has been deeply absorbed into all the tactics that are actually practiced or are planned for in any major combat. What you see in demos is, you know, something which is for greater visual effect. So you will necessarily see the more spectacular kind of weapons, which are guns and rockets and stuff like that. But one should not mistake that for the understanding on behalf of even our current understanding, I would say for the last at least 20 plus years, that we need to avoid these weapons and stay outside the umbrella and still be able to do the tasks that are assigned. So standoff weaponry is clearly understood, whether it's naval aviation with its anti-ship missiles or whether it's the standoff missiles, the whole range which the Air Force has gone about procuring. You will obviously not see too many of them being fired off
because they're very expensive.
Demonstration,
right.
Because they're very expensive, exactly.
Right. I also wanted to, Commodore, bring you in on, you know, the naval aspect of things, and you've served on warships as well. We saw the loss of one of the premier naval assets, the Moskva. It had at least a three-tiered layered defense system with a very sophisticated surface-to-air missile system. Is India competent now in our Navy to take on the nature of threat which a ship like this faced?
See, what you are, just to digress a little bit from what the specific question you asked, what you are seeing on TV is a mixture of incompetence, of facing an enemy who refuses to fight the way you expect him to fight, denial of these newer forms of warfare. The anti-ship missile is over 50 years old. The top attack weapon against armor is hardly something that is, arisen in the last few years. So it's really what you need to understand is you're asking about whether the high value platform has outlived its usefulness versus these this different form of warfare. I think if you just look at it in terms of the small drone, which currently is below the detection threshold, but then its ability to inflict damage is also that small. The Bayraktar, which can pierce a tank, is detectable and is can be brought down fairly easily. The real worry is not of an enemy who uses drones, because drones somehow seems to symbolize the enemy and is been made into a big bogeyman. Mm-hmm. I think the real worry is when somebody leverages the real power of AI, autonomy, and drones, and then puts it together in a system which can completely swamp your defenses, even complex defenses, even very sophisticated defenses, which are able to detect drones. I mean, a swarm of 50 drones, even if you detect all 50, is going to be impossible to stave off. So we should not miss the wood for the trees. The real threat that is coming and that we must be ready for is AI, autonomy, human and machine, teaming up into systems which offer themselves or appear in different forms, every time in a different form, whether it's cyber, whether it's small drones, whether it's networked forces, whether it's missiles that are smart and are able to, discern through all the countermeasures that are put up against it. So I think the making judgments on the basis of what we are seeing, I think General Dhanoa was trying to allude to that. I don't think he's in denial. I think he's trying to allude to the fact that it's a little early to draw conclusions based on the one-sided videos that are coming. Every one of those tanks may be genuine, but that's not the story. You could also be seeing a story of incompetence. I mean, a ship of that nature being lost to a shore battery is, frankly,
is a sign of incompetence. General, just one final question to you, because I'm running short on time. And I'm sure you would agree that logistics is equal to life. The reason I raise that point is because we saw disastrous logistics management north of Kiev. The Russians have lost the war. I mean, if regime change was their goal, that's not happening. So therefore, in the context of India, how important is it for us to keep thinking about robust logistics? We keep talking about weapons and systems and tactics, but robust logistics being equivalent to life itself.
Oh, absolutely. And the Indian Army has been in some kind of a fits and starts kind of transformation for the last 15 odd years. And you would have heard numerous committees talking about reducing the teeth to tail ratio. Well, unfortunately, it is the tail which wags the teeth,
right?
If I may modify that saying. And if you are going to make your tail so tiny and so bereft of the ability to do the job, then unfortunately you may have the strongest teeth, but they will flounder the way it happened in Russia, to the Russians in the initial stages. So what I would like to say is that definitely we do take a look, and from the time that I was in service, yes, the operational planning and making the big arrows on the maps, that occupies the minds of a lot of senior officers, but it is the logistician, you know, who has to actually be able to do the real jobs and to make sure that ammunition, that fuel, life-saving equipment is available at the right time and at the right place. And that's something which we found, that since that was not happening, you had those initial thrusts, which were very fast, which reached the outskirts of Kyiv, but then they had to withdraw. Right. So in our case, I think definitely robust logistics, we need to take a look at as to, and this is something which is ongoing. And unfortunately, when it comes to a northern neighbor, geography is against the Indian military to some extent.
Right.
But we've been overcoming it. I think there's been a sustained push over the last
10
odd years to get your robust logistics in place. But you can only plan up to that point where your logistics is assured. If you start to make plans, grandiose plans to go deep into enemy territory, unfortunately, it is the logistics which will dictate the reach that you have.
Right. Okay. Look, gentlemen, I'm out of time. Thank you so much for joining us. Some key points emerging out of the Ukraine situation. Where does India stand? You've got a couple of experts over there with their viewpoint on this. Out of time on Left, Right and Center from all of us here.